Okay, let's dive into one of the biggest questions in economics, one that really gets to the heart of how a country works. When a government decides to spend more money, you know, on roads, schools, whatever, where does that money actually come from? And more importantly, what's the real cost?
So this is the big puzzle we're going to try to solve today. And we're going to look at it through a really specific lens, the classical school of economics. They have a fascinating and maybe even a kind of surprising answer. And believe it or not, it all comes down to one single really powerful idea.
All right, first things first. Before we can even begin to answer our question, we have to get on the same page as these classical economists. Their entire view of the world is built on one golden rule, one core assumption that changes everything else. And here it is. In their world, the economy is always running at full steam. Just imagine it. There are no idle factories collecting dust, no workers sitting at home wishing they had a job. Every single person, every machine, every resource is already being used as efficiently as it possibly can be. The economy is firing on all cylinders 24/7.
Now, if the economy is already producing everything it possibly can, what does that tell you? It means you can't just magically create more stuff. The total size of the economic pie, all the goods and services produced in a year, is fixed. It is what it is. The only thing you can really do is change how you slice up that pie. Now remember that fixed pie. Seriously, lock it in your brain. It is the key to this whole thing.
So let's play this out. Here's our first scenario. The government decides it wants a bigger slice of the pie. It wants to spend more. And to pay for it, it's going to borrow the money by selling government bonds. What happens next? Well, it sets off this incredible chain reaction.
Let's just walk through this. Step one. The government starts spending. That immediately boosts the overall demand for stuff in the economy. But wait, remember the golden rule? The supply is fixed. You've got more money chasing the exact same amount of goods, so prices have to go up. Now, to get this spending money, the government is borrowing from the nation's savings. With the government jumping into the loan market, the demand for loans goes up, and that pushes up the price of a loan, which we call the interest rate. So what happens when interest rates climb? Well, if you're a business, borrowing money to build a new factory just got a whole lot more expensive. So you don't. Private investment drops.
And this whole effect, it's got a name you've probably heard before, crowding out. It's a great name for it, right? The government's borrowing has literally crowded out private companies from being able to borrow and invest.
And this is where it all comes together so beautifully. Just look at the math. The total pie, Y, can't change. It's fixed. And in this scenario, people's private consumption, C, hasn't really changed either. So if the government slice, G, gets bigger, that extra slice has to come from somewhere, right? And we just saw exactly where. It comes straight out of private investment, I.
So the takeaway here is pretty stark. You get what we call full crowding out. It's a perfect one-for-one swap. For every single new dollar the government borrows and spends, a dollar of private investment disappears from the economy.
Okay, but wait a minute. Borrowing isn't the only way for government to get money. What if they choose a different path? What happens if, instead of racking up debt, they decide to pay for all this new spending by just raising our taxes?
Right, so the goal is exactly the same, more government spending. But the playbook for how to pay for it is completely different. And as you're about to see, that changes the final score in a really big way.
So the government spends more. And just like before, that pushes demand up. But here's the big twist. They also raise taxes. That means you and I have less money in our pockets after payday. So what do? We cut back on our own spending, we consume less. Now this drop in our consumption actually cancels out some of the government's new spending. The overall jump in demand is way smaller this time. And because of that, prices and interest rates don't spike nearly as much, which means private investment doesn't take as big of a hit.
Let's go back to our pie. The total pie, Y, is still fixed. The government slice, G, is still getting bigger. But this time, where's that extra room coming from? Well, it's coming from two places now. Part of it comes from us, private consumption, C, because we have less to spend. And the rest of it still comes from private investment, I.
So this time, we get what's called partial crowding out. See the difference? The cost of that bigger government slice isn't all on the shoulders of private investors anymore. The burden is now shared. Consumers pay some of the price by consuming less, and investors pay the rest.
Okay, so we've seen two different ways for the government to pay its bills, and each one leads to a pretty different result. Now we get to the really important question. What does this difference actually mean for the economy's future? Why should we care?
This slide just lays it all out, plain and simple. When the government finances its spending with debt, private investment takes the full hit, 100%. But when it uses taxes, that cost gets spread out between us, the consumers, and the investors.
And this is the bottom line. Why does all this matter? Well, because that private investment, that's the engine of future economic growth. It's businesses building new factories, creating new technologies, all the stuff that makes the pie bigger tomorrow. And according to this classical model, paying for spending with debt hurts that engine of growth way more than paying for it with taxes.
So, let's just zoom out for a second. After going through all that, what is the big overarching lesson that the classical school of thought wants us to take away from this whole exercise?
It really boils down to three simple, powerful ideas. First, when the economy is already at its limit, there's no such thing as a free lunch. Second, if the government takes a bigger piece of that fixed pie, someone else's piece has to get smaller. It's just simple arithmetic. And third, the choice between funding with debt or taxes, well, that's really a choice about who in the private sector is going to be the one to pay the price.
And that leads us to the final, absolutely critical question. This entire classical story, this whole beautiful chain of logic, is built on that one golden rule, that the pie is fixed because the economy is at full employment. But what if it's not? What happens to this whole story if there are unemployed people who could be working and idle factories that could be running? What then? Well, my friends, that is a fantastic question for another time.